Family wants to come in with the deceased and their mum, so I'll speak to them how best they can come in. Thank you.
before they die, they'll still live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will live forever. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercy never comes to an end. They are new every morning. In the world, you have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help. Dear friends, I warmly welcome you, especially the family, Auntie, Jesse, Michael, Annabelle, and the grandchildren and all the families, those who are here or those who may be following in Ghana. I offer a sincere condolences to you. But not only to you, but to the whole church family here. Because the late Cornelius Francis Dowuona was a very precious member of the church, a quiet giant, and we are all affected by his departure. But we are here to thank God and to celebrate his life for all what he has given to his family, to his friends, to his colleagues, and to the church. And pray for all of us. So it is our privilege to be here this morning to do this act of Thanksgiving celebration. And I'll be assisted by my dear colleague, Reverend Papa Owusu. And I acknowledge your presence in the congregation of my predecessor, my dear colleague, friend, Reverend David Butterworth. I warmly welcome you. You knew the family, and we appreciate that you have traveled all the way to be healed. May God bless you as we are all bound together in Christ. So, again, we meet in this solemn moment to worship God and to give thanks to God for our dear dad, granddad, husband, friend, colleague, church member, uncle, Cornelius, Francis, Nee, Okwei, Dowuona, and to commend him to God's loving and faithful care, and to pray for all who mourn. In the presence of death, our Lord Jesus Christ offers sure ground for hope and confidence, and even for joy, because he shared our human life and death, was raised again triumphant, and lived forevermore. And in him, his people will find eternal life. So, as the family have chosen, we'll be starting this service of Thanksgiving celebration with the first hymn, as we meet in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, with the hymn, Blessed Assured. The hymns, the words are not in the booklet, but all the word will be on the screen. All the word will be on the screen. Blessed Assurance.
Glory divine.
there are still some few vacant seats upstairs. There are still vacant seats upstairs. And here I invite
close at hand in times of trouble. As we gather together this morning to bid farewell to Cornelius Dowuona, help us so to hear your word that our fear may be dispelled, our loneliness eased, and our hope reawakened. May your Holy Spirit lift us above our sorrow to the peace and light of your constant love. Loving God, it is you who brought us to birth. And so as we are here this morning, help us to live as those who are prepared for death. Enable us to hear your message of death overcome and life renewed. That as we may face the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity through Jesus Christ, our risen Savior. Amen.
Amen.
So we sing again, in times like this, we have no other to look to but to look up to God. So the hymn is, through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy, the praises of my God shall stir my heart and tongue and pen. We stand to sing for those who are able.
Thank you.
are going to invite my girl, Dowuona, to come and tell us who Cornelius Francis Me Okwei Dowuona was.
Cornelius was born to Robert Dinoy Dwumfour of the Osun Royal House, King Hale, and Charlotte Okeiko Okente of Anomansa Osu. Both are blessed memories. His grandfather was an engineer at Kwasi Mines, so that was where he lived with his parents. He started his education at Okwei until the family returned to Okwei. He obtained his BSc degree at the University of Cape Coast. He worked with GIHOC. He was also a teacher at Radiant Way Preparatory School. He later left Ghana for the UK for further studies. He explored different fields, got a driving instructor certificate, and helped both family members and friends with their driving lessons. He got his degree in economics and political science at Middlesex University and his master's at UCL. He worked in private and government organizations. He was instrumental in running the laundry and dry cleaning business, a business that was run successfully for many years. He worked tirelessly with his family. His help and support for his siblings and their children was extensive. He extended his help to any member of the extended family and friends who approached him for help. His dedication knew no bounds, and he was always there to lend a helping hand no matter the challenge. He made a conscious choice to pursue his passion for music. Cornelius was an avid collector of albums by artists such as Marvin Gaye and Paul Simon. His love for music and his interest in history motivated him and my mum's visits to the West End to watch musicals like The Jersey Boys, The Black Mikado and Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dream. He had a beautiful singing voice, and it was often wondered why he didn't join the church choir or take up singing professionally. His collection of albums was always at the heart of his family collection, conversations, and how they could be preserved. He had a deep appreciation for Italian culture, mastering the language and travelling to Italy and other places to explore the rich heritage. Cornelius was a master of many trades. He willingly took on various DIY projects, excelling each time with determination. There was nothing he couldn't fix or improve, whether it was repairing a coffee table or mending a roof for the children. His skills were unparalleled. He even crafted toys for the little ones, and his grandson, Ezra, will always remember the loving and attentive granddad who could make anything. Whenever he fixed things, he'd step back in admiration. He'd then turn around and say jokingly to my mum, "Jess, do you still need to bring in the professionals? Or do you think I've earned myself a pint of lager? He didn't even drink alcohol. So that says a lot about his sense of humour. Cornelius was an instrumental figure in his community. He actively engaged in activities in the neighbourhood to ensure our safety in the homes. Whenever the children were in need, Cornelius stepped in without hesitation. Whether it was a late football practice or needing some extra hands to take care of things, Cornelius was there, ensuring that they had the support they needed. His love for photography led him to initiate a family photo album project, capturing beautiful moments and creating lasting memories for us all to cherish. Cornelius' legacy goes beyond his own family. He was dedicated to making a positive impact in the community, particularly through his involvement in the Belle Aqua Foundation. where he contributed to various initiatives aimed at improving the lives of others. Cornelius was an ardent reader, and he encouraged his family to read extensively. He had a vast collection of books and was known for his warmth and protection. He was always there to provide guidance and support, leaving us with a sense of peace and tranquility. While Cornelius may have left this earthly plane, the impact he has made on our lives will stay with us forever. We take solace in knowing that he is now in the arms of the Almighty, and we are grateful for his love, kindness, and wisdom that he bestowed upon us. Cornelius's generous spirit and tireless dedication will forever be remembered. He gave so much and gave the best of himself, but asked for so little. What a gentle giant. May his gentle soul rest in peace, in perfect peace. Ayakul, ayakul, ayakul.
You did well. Let's put our hands together. Ayakul, ayakul.
Dear husband, so do not fear, for I am with you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand, for I am the Lord, your God, who takes hold of your right, and says to you, do not fear, for I will help you. Isaiah 41, verse 10 and 13. It was a day during our summer holidays from school, in 19, when we first met my brother Ebenezer. He took me to see his friend Raphael at Osu. Raphael, your cousin, introduced me to you. He then asked us to exchange school addresses. He produced an A4 size notebook and took down my address in the middle of that notebook. Little did we know that we were going to fill that notebook with our love story. A story that covered 57 to 58 years of our lives. How do I narrate 7 years of history in 5 to 10 minutes? With my brothers and as escorts, we walked the beaches of Osu, listening to music and talking about the world affairs. Even at a young age, we knew so much about the world history and current affairs. We spent time at Black Star Square when there were no public events. When the Soul to Soul musical event came to Ghana, you took me to Black Star Square to watch it. Our children were surprised when you told them that we saw Tina Turner and Wilson Pickett that night. Connie, where did you go? My mum always admired your quietness, gentleness, and humility. You first visited our house wearing a white shirt, a scene my mum commented on throughout the years. Your quietness continued through the 57 years of our lives together. We laughed, cried together, and the rest of the world never heard a whisper. Our world was like an island in a spring. And there was no one and nothing in between. only God stood in the midst of it all. Your devotion and love for our children.
Grandchildren stood out for all to see. When our daughter Charlotte passed away, you said you felt like a part of you was gone, but we needed you, so you would carry on. You dedicated your time and energy to ensure the children and the grandchildren's welfare, and they all returned the love unquestionably. You worked hard to make our family business a success. You fixed anything and everything around the house. You even joked about owning shares and being killed. Your willingness to help anyone who asked for help, both friends and family, made you unique. All these you did in quietness. You always said you were not afraid of hard work. Your motto was, and I quote, "They also serve who stand and wait." As the years went by, I realized that the statement summed you up. Your patience and your love for your fellow human beings said a lot about you. Oh dear, a heart of gold stopped beating, working hands at rest. God broke my heart to prove to me he only takes the best. You asked for so little, but gave so much. Is this real? I'm still dreaming, waiting to be told it's not happening, but God knows best. I could go on forever, because our story never ended. I salute you, my friend. Thank you for being a good husband. I thank you for being a good father to our children. I thank you for being the best granddad to our grandchildren. Most of all, I thank you for being by my side through it all, and for being you. May God, Lord, grant you peace, and keep you gentle, and keep your gentle soul in safekeeping till we meet again.
We are taking the children's tribute.
Children tribute from Anita. You exemplified the strength of stability, emphasizing that consistent behavior carries more weight than dramatic gestures. Early on, you instilled in me a love for culture, teaching that the world extends far beyond our hometown. Life, you said, is about exploring what the world offers, and more importantly, what you can offer to the world. I am undeniably my father's daughter. Fish is one thing, but when you add the extra seasoning from the start, that's what really makes it taste sweet. Despite the blessings surrounding me, there was always a tiny missing piece that I sensed you longed for. And that was your special place in the sunshine back home in Dowuona. And that love spilled right over to me from a very young age. You taught me that life has a rhythm and showed me the magic of expressing yourself through song. So come what may, if I'm having a bad day, that will forever be my go-to. I cherish countless precious moments from the cute little girl, pretty in pink, in my favorite poncho. You carried me around the park at Pickett's Lock, and our long walks, those little things will always mean a lot. Your love of sport and respect for sportsmanship, I will never forget watching the championship boxing match, Azuma Nelson versus Barry McGowan. For the first time, I saw you in a whole new light. The passion for the fight was unforgettable. Along with your love of music and that you shared,
There was always a common message within the songs you played. You put on a tape in the car or vinyl in the house, a Pan-African or reggae megamix. Though I couldn't understand all the words, I knew there was a rhythm and a vibe that could transport you to another place, where worries would just fade away. Operation Pepper and Sprites, cornmeal porridge, or rice and peas left over for breakfast. As you got in from work, to when you left, you always cooked up some comfort food from back home with your famous container of food. You always took it with you to work. You made me understand the greatest blessings are meant to be shared. Whether big or small, the goal is to make a positive impact in the simplest of ways. If you're privileged enough to do so, then do it with a genuine heart. You taught me the power of self-restraint and the ability to keep your head when others are losing theirs. You always ensured that we grasp the importance of humility, never letting pride overshadow the exercise or forget the fundamental purpose behind the goal you were trying to achieve. Dad had so many unforgettable sayings. Those days when you took me to my first driving lessons, you would say, quote, "Once you are a driver, you can drive any car." You taught me that everything in this universe has its unique and divine purpose and rhythm. It's down to us to choose our approach, and that's what really determines the outcome. Do your research, you'd say, so you're ready for the bumps in the road. When one of the grandchildren faced an obstacle, you were there to make sense of it all. Your words put a finer point on it. You once asked Shalise why she always had had that hair tie around her head. She was surprised you noticed, and she came up with all sorts of excuses. You drew the line in your own unique way and asked her, quote, "When you step out, who looks like you?" She said, "No one, Granddad." And it's like the room said amen. From that day, her confidence grew in every aspect of her life. She knew that a gesture so small could lead to something so big. That was you, Dad. If there was one word to describe how I feel in view of such a huge loss, the only word that could suffice is hashtag privilege. To me, this is what privilege looks like. You taught me to try to get to the root of a problem to find a solution. This final saying that summed it up in a nutshell, and that I never seem to forget, is that when the rain falls and the sun shines, the flowers will grow. You taught me, and that's a blessing. Sadly, I'm forced to accept that we are merely players in this game called life. So again, I thank God for the privilege of calling you my dad. So until we meet again and laugh together again, rest in unrivaled peace and paradise. Love always, Annie, Anita.
At times like this, it's common to make pleasant statements about somebody, and to a certain extent, they're usually all true. But when it comes to Frank Dwumfour, Uncle Frank, Dad, if you knew him, you'd know that there are just no words. But I'll do my best. You've heard his story, but it's when we look at him as a loving husband and father he was that his journey really comes to life. So can I talk about his character? His sense of humour was built on a steady diet of characters like Del Boy from Only Fools and Horses and Arthur Daly from Mindo. On the surface, they couldn't be more different to him. But when you zoom out, you realise that what he saw in him was sweet, well-meaning, vulnerable humans driven by values, principles and heart. Like many men of his generation, he was an avid watcher of James Bond films when we were young. Looking back, probably not the best role model for an 8-year-old boy. Still, as always with Dad, he was looking at it from a completely different angle, drawing me to wonder at the exotic locations, adventure, and colourful characters that appeared larger than life on screen. My dad knew that we were all born as beautifully imperfect works in progress, and his answer to this was to navigate the world as a man of principle and superhuman empathy. So let me talk about his heart. He knew loss and struggle, but somehow answered these situations and every other challenge with love. He didn't just care deeply for people and how they lived. He would use whatever tools he had at his disposal to impact things, usually in the ways that the average person would miss. He'd catch you off guard with a sincere compliment when you least expected, but somehow most needed it. He'd celebrate the everyday successes of those around him, like he himself had won the lottery. He was fun and had a weird ability to make people feel good even when he was teasing them, which he did often. He lived his life in gratitude, and as a result, even the smallest thing you did for him would pay off 10 times over when you saw him smile and deliver a humble thank you. Let me talk about his power. When my dad fell ill some years ago, around the same time Ezra, his first grandson, was born, we spent day after day on the ward at North Middlesex Hospital while he received treatment. Even at the time when I knew he was physically tired, worried, and scared, he would somehow smile and complain about politics or the latest headline. He had the power to make you feel like everything would be all right, no matter how tough things were. He wasn't fearless, he was courageous. He showed me what true power looks like. We're amongst friends, family, and loved ones, so I have to be honest. My dad wouldn't want me to talk about him without talking about his flaws. He didn't have much time for pretense, insincerity, or ego. In his eyes, it all got in the way of what mattered. That being said, I wanted him to want more for himself and get more of what he deserved in life. I wanted him to protect himself from those seeking to take advantage. Only in reflection do I realize why he didn't look at things that way. In his eyes, he'd already won. He'd drive Mum mad with his major one-man construction projects that he'd work out in real time with rarely more than a sketch of an envelope as a plan. Somehow they always came together in the end, and in those moments he was truly satisfied. He knew what he was doing at all times, one of the most self-aware people you will ever meet. I can't talk about his flaws without mentioning how bad he was at telling jokes. Worse yet, he knew it. So one of his favourite things to do was to wear us down around the table by telling bad jokes, bad Christmas cracker jokes, as badly as he possibly could until you just had to laugh. I watched someone who woke up every day still wanting to be the best he possibly could for those he loved. So can I talk about his love? He was a creator who was most at ease when building something. More often than not, when I speak to Mum, he'd be in the background, up a ladder, or hammering something, making one of his upgrades. Of all his loves, by far his greatest was my mum and the family they built together. Having remained a team through the countless challenges life throws at you, they're not only an inspiration, but a blueprint. After all those years, seeing someone still care enough to want to impress their partner and lift them up was nothing short of amazing to witness. He gave my mum and all of us his everything. In later years, we were lucky enough to be able to spend almost every Sunday afternoon together, something that I already miss. Mum and Dad provided a sanctuary for us to just be, no matter how busy the week had been or what was going on. They tell us about Ghana, we talk about the world, the latest on I'm a celebrity or nothing at all. He would love playing with his grandchildren, and I'd quietly laugh to myself when I saw the competitor in him come out, even if it was when he was showing no mercy to my four-year-old daughter in a game of Uno. I owe him in large part my career in music. He was someone who fiercely championed education, but believed in following your ambitions. I spent as much time reading record sleeves as I did doing my times tables growing up, imagining the stories behind the classics by Marvin Gaye, Elvis, Paul Simon, the Queen, the Chi Lads, the Carpenters, Jackie Wilson, and Stevie Wonder, and so many more. Through his collection, I learned that none of us are just one thing, and how to remain curious in life. Once I started in the business, the few times I would talk about my experience, I could tell his pride didn't come from the names I've mentioned. It came from the fact that I stepped up, forged a path, and was making it happen. Throughout our family, I see a legacy of purpose, ambition, and courage to see the path most travelled as a guide rather than a predetermined route. This is all because of the room he created for us to be. My dad reminded me of everyone's favourite teacher at school, the patient one, who took time to understand you and then found a way to get the message across in the way that you needed to receive it. So finally, I'll talk about his lessons. He taught me to be someone of value, with values. He taught me to contribute. My dad was a knowledgeable contributor, a curious listener, and a protector. He was a citizen of the world and taught me how to zoom out to see the bigger picture. He taught me that it's almost never about me, but I'm just part of something bigger. If I ever doubted myself, he found a way to let me know that only the weak will take your kindness for weakness. So to see kindness as a strength. He wasn't afraid to fight. His lesson was just to be certain of what you're fighting for. It's always a choice. That simple idea has guided me through countless situations in work, life, family, and as I navigate through the world on a day-to-day. My natural way is to rationalize, to work it out, to accept, and get back up when things don't go to plan. But just as surely as he made me, protected and guided me, I'm certain that his passing will forever change me. I'm not greedy, but I'd be lying if I said I didn't want just one more day. I'd take him to see Andrea Bocelli one more time. Even be willing to suffer through a game at the Emirates Stadium, I'd ask him about his dreams. Beyond his tears, worries and pain, I'm deeply thankful to have shared a life and been cared for by someone so smart, playful, complex, generous and loving. Some don't even get a day. We had more than our fair share. Now has been called home. On August 18, 1946, the sun shined a little brighter, the air smelled a little sweeter, the smiles lingered a little longer. On October 5th, 2023, our sky turned grey. But as we lay into rest, I smile in the knowledge that everything he represented lives on through the people who loved him and those whose lives he touched. Through his eyes, we've already won.
I love my dad. I will intentionally refer to my love for dad in the present tense. Even though I can no longer speak, joke, laugh, or learn new things from him, my love for him will never die. I love him. He was quiet and only spoke when he felt he had something worth saying. He loved learning new things, especially languages. He could speak Latin and had been learning Italian for the last 10 years of his life. I loved him. He enjoyed witty jokes and smiling, but believed that in life there was always room for improvement. Dad always showed up and supported people, not expecting the favour to be returned. Years ago, Dad began illness and never complained once or felt sorry for himself. He carried himself with dignity throughout that difficult journey. I love him. He loved my mum. They were perfect for each other. Their decades-long marriage should be an example to us all. They made each other laugh and worked well as a team. My parents' work ethic is something I'll aim to pass on to my daughter. I love him. His sense of humor, comedic timing, and wit were unmatched. I remember some time ago in the living room, Dad, unprompted, took my hand and said, quote, "Your hands remind me so much of my mom's hands." I smiled. "Feel your bottom," he continued. "They're so long and skinny and big." With a tight smile, I slowly retreated my hand and chuckled. I love him. Dad was very non-judgmental and could move with the times. You could be as unique as you wanted to in front of him, and he wouldn't bat an eye. My husband Rob and I got married in 2018
on my dad's birthday, 18th of August. I don't know how I'm going to live the rest of my life without him, but I'm glad he was my dad. I love him.
We want to take a tribute by your lordship.
Stay here.
And the rest of the tributes will be taken in during their repast. So this will be our last.
Absolutely loved about him was his storytelling. I mean, have you ever heard him recount his stories about his life and history? It's like, well, Granddad, I never knew. He had this way of making every story fascinating, and I cherish those moments.
And let's talk about his humor. His jokes were a classic. Even though these are the ones that made you roll your eyes a bit, you couldn't help but laugh. I remember the time I had a wedding made here in the dance hall. I forgot whose wedding it was, but Granddad had some serious moves. His taste in music was fantastic. He could even carry a tune himself. He was just an all-round lovely man. His presence was like this calming force, even in tense situations. He remained calm. I just couldn't help but be influenced by that. I mean, he wants to raise their voice when he's around, right? That's what I miss the most, his smile and that calm temperament. It's like he had this power that made everything feel okay.
Granddad, we miss you so much. Your presence was truly one of a kind. And it's hard to believe you're not here with us anymore. We will always love you and never forget you. Love, Faray, Shalise, Ezra, Saran, and Ahima.
Thank you.
We are going to call Sister Juliet to play, and then we hear from the church. We are going to continue from this place, you know, we're going to go to the hall for the repast, and we'll take all the rest of the tributes there as well. So let's hear from the church, because she was part of this, and he was part of this.
Thank you. Sisters, death shows no favoritism based on status, social status, wealth, age, or gender. It's impartial. According to the scriptures, it's ordained for every individual to confront this inevitable conclusion. Ultimately, each one of us will undergo this experience of mortality. We gather here today to celebrate the life of our loving brother, Cornelius Francis Ni Okwei Dowuona, affectionately known as Uncle Frank. Though our hearts are heavy with grief, let us honor him by remembering the joy, love, and laughter he brought into our lives. A man of quiet strength, wisdom, unassuming grace, he touched the lives of everyone fortunate enough to know him. Within the intricate fabric of our congregation, some threads wave in silence, yet carry the robustness of steadfast dedication. Blessed are those quiet servants, for in their humility, they mirror the divine artistry of selfless labor. As we honor our dear brother, whose action resonates louder than words, let us recall that even in the most tranquil corners, God's grace discovers its most devoted vessels. In a world that often applauds the loudest voice, Uncle Frank has demonstrated the beauty of gentle spirit and a servant's heart. His contribution, though unassuming, have been the glue that binds us together. As the cherished husband of our senior steward, Auntie Jessie, he played an integral role in the spiritual embroidery of our church, contributing not only through his service, but also through his warmth of his presence. He was a member of the main fellowship, you know, but we never spotted him at all. Uncle Frank stood as a symbol of wisdom and humility, while not necessarily the most vocal presence in the room. His words held profound depth that resonated with everyone fortunate enough to hear him. His dedication to the faith, his faith extended beyond the boundaries of our church. It infused every facet of his existence. His act of kindness, generosity, and steadfast support touched numerous lives, imprinting an enduring impact on the lives, on the hearts of his fortunate, of those fortunate enough to encounter him. As we mourn his loss, let us also celebrate the legacy he leaves behind. Let his life be a reminder that true greatness often resides in the gentle spirit of quiet, gentle strength of quiet spirit, and that wisdom is often found in the honest human corners of our community. As we plan for his final resting place, we offer prayers for good Lord to grant him everlasting peace and welcome him into the embrace of the spirit above. Though we deeply feel his absence, heaven rejoices at his arrival. His legacy of faith, love, and humility will continue to inspire us all. The earth has one gentle soulless, and heaven one angel more. Deep in our hearts, a memory is kept of one we loved and shall never forget. Uncle Frank, your life is a beautiful memory. Your absence a silent grief. God bless and keep you in his care until we meet again. Chenu, Yawo Duba. Yawo Duba, Mokabo Atu. Rest in peace, Frank.
Thank you. Let's put our hands together for all of them. We sing again, you go on belief, my Savior is near, and for my relief will surely appear by prayer as we wrestle, and he will perform with Christ in the vessel was my heart's soul. We start to sing for those who are able.
Thank you.
hear the words of Holy Scripture, that from them we may draw comfort and strength.
He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep you. You are going out and you are coming in from this time on and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
And sing my soul, my
Savior,
unto
thee.
Michael, Annabelle, and Anita, and
accept our deepest condolences and may the soul of our dear Uncle Frank rest in perfect peace. Amen. As I've been reflecting for the past few months, when we meet on an occasion like this, I think it's about three key things. The first one is about celebrating fond memories, because yes, we are talking about the loss, the passing away of Uncle Frank. And if we are not careful, we'll just focus on the loss and forget about the fond memories that he has left behind. Celebrating fond memories, of course, the body will decay, but what will be imperishable is the legacy that he has left behind. And this, the legacy that we need to keep passing by, especially the youngest grandchildren he has left, so that what they remember is their granddad, a gentle giant who was fond of history, a gentle giant who did his masters as UCL, I never knew that. A gentle giant who had a special interest in Italian culture. He doesn't need a kind of curiosity to be interested in other people's culture, because that enriches him. A gentle giant who, I'm sure, on top of many Ghanaian languages and English, could also speak Latin. A gentle giant who was there, a loving dad, a caring granddad. The legacy, Auntie Jessie, remember that year, 1965, when you first met. Remember that first visit he made to the family home, dressed in white shirts. Remember, even his sense of humor, telling bad jokes just to make people laugh. Remember that he was someone who enjoys celebrating over people's everyday successes, as if he had won lottery. He does need someone with humility to invest in other people's life. Celebrating someone else's daily success, it does, that means really someone who was really selfless. And as a church, what I remember, someone quite, he'll always try to come just before me, and that's when he'll be reversing to park. And I always say, Auntie Jesse, you have your own personal driver who will make sure he will drop you right at the church. I said, if he could, he could have taken you until the church and make sure that you got to the church before he parked. A gentle man who always sits there at the back there. And so many things, just yesterday, that I learned that he's part of those who will always drive as a steward to take them to the bank to make deposits, to make sure that they got safely. Those are things that we need to remember and tell the story to grandchildren, that they may remember their grandma who was coming. And when I went to visit you, Auntie Jessie, you told me grandchildren, whenever they were or going to football, when there was a problem with boss, they'll come home knowing that granddad would track them. It was easier to rely on granddad than to rely on public transport. That's what they need to remember. Let's not focus on the sadness of a loss. And I listened to George. You say, yes, the earth may have lost a giant, but the heaven has gained another angel. That was very well put. So that's about celebrating fond memory. The second point is about accepting God's timing. I still remember that Sunday when you, Auntie Jessie, you informed us that you were traveling to Ghana with your husband for 3 months. And we all say, we pray and say, upon the day I gave you call, and we talk. You went to Ghana for 3 months with your husband. And I still remember when I received your text, well, when you have time, just let me know, I want to share something with you. And when I called you, I started teasing you as I always did. I said, Auntie Jessie, have you made breakfast for your husband who found this morning? You kept quiet. I said, don't tell me now that you are in Ghana, you have stopped making breakfast for my uncle Frank. And after you may say, your dear friend, Uncle Frank, had just died. What? I was speechless. And it was you say, Rev, are you still there? Are you still there? Because I could not believe what had just happened. And that was just 10 days after your child. And you know me, in this church, I always say, I don't know what my life will be in the next 1 hour. If anybody here can tell me that they know exactly what their life will be in the next hour, raise your hand and I'll be consulting you later. I don't know. But when it happened, is really sad. Uncle Frank passing away just 10 days after you travel. And this is where God is about us. He's saying, there's a time to be born, there's a time to die. And that's why we need to know that our life is a precious gift to us. And if there's anything positive that we can do today, let's do it. If we can make a positive difference in the life of someone today, let's do it, because tomorrow may be too late. Tomorrow may be too late. We only know about today. We don't know about tomorrow. We only know about this hour. We don't know about the next hour. That's why, brothers and sisters, friends, is James, in the Epistle of James, he said, if anyone knows any good thing to do and fail to do it, they have committed sin. Because that means you have wasted an opportunity God has given you to do something. If you can tell someone, I love you, I like the way, was it Anita? Say really, I love him. It's my dad. I love him. Keep repeating that to your children, so that they know that they had a granddad who was so good at mom that say, I love him. If there's anything we can do today, let's do it, because God's time is not our time. He has his own time, and we need to accept it. Because that breath of life is something precious no money can buy. Accepting God's time. Yes, Auntie Jessie, when you are going, you're expecting to go to Ghana and come back with your husband, but it was not to be. But remember, God has given you about 57 years together, and that's what we need to thank God for. Because if we could give him instruction, we say, no, we want to live together until we are 100. Okay, I celebrated a wedding of a young couple last year, and their dream is to be together until they are 100. And Joe, can you remind us? 109. But that's it. God has got their own time. Accepting God's time, if we can. And the final point is keeping faith and hope. And this is where the two Bible readings that you have chosen come in. The first, Psalm 1:2:1. It's a psalm that's called the Traveler's Prayer. The Traveler's Prayer. It says, He will keep you as you come and go. He will not allow the sun to hurt you during the day, not the moon to hurt you during the night. He will keep you. And this is it. This is the prayer that we need to keep praying. It's not now that he passed away that we stop. No. Because we'll keep traveling. Am I right? Yes. Let's keep traveling. And let's keep making those prayers. Because as we take off, flying over seas and mountains, we can only rely. Because it's not the first time. He has always been going to Ghana, am I right? And he was the one God has always been keeping you. You have asked you so many things that you have done together. He was there. And you, children, grandchildren, keep faith in God who has protected your dad in the past, your mom in the past. And Jesse, we pray for you because I believe that you will be one who has the issue, and that he has always been there for you. He will not allow you to take public transport. He said, no, I want to make sure, because I'm not sure. He will always be there for you. And we pray now that it has gone. It felt weird last time when I came to visit you for the first time to see the empty space there, because he has always become like brother and sister. And now it's gone. And the second Bible reading from Romans, chapter 8. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Is it death? persecution. Is it? No. We are more than conquerors through Christ who loves. And Jesse, Michael, Anita, God loves you. It's not because your dad has passed away that God has stopped loving you. He was the one who promised, I'll be your God and you'll be my people. You are still his precious children. And we pray that when you find yourself at the wrong part of your life, not knowing where to go, especially if that was here, if none that was here, we pray that Lord, who say that I will be your God and you'll be my people, will speak. We pray that he may give you obedient heart. We pray that when you go through joys or anxiety, you may hear his voice. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. And as we go, we are not speaking to Uncle Frank, because Uncle Frank is at another level now. It's about us. It's about us. The life that God has given to us, how we use it to build each other up. It was Martin Luther King Jr. who said, unless we learn to live together and love one another, we die together as fools. God has given us love, especially in this time of Advent. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. He gave his life. And we have come to pass on what God has given us. God loves us, and he has asked God to do what? To love one another. God has given us forgiveness and has asked us to pass on forgiveness. I'm standing before you this morning because God has forgiven me, made me past mistakes. And who am I to say, I will never. Keeping faith. And I like the song, but it says, keeping hope. Because he lives, I can face soon. Because he lives, all fear is gone. And life is worth living just. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know, he holds the I don't know what the future holds for me, but I know who holds the future. So I entrust my life in him who holds the future. Am I right? No, I'm not going to entrust my life in the land, in the house, in the car. Are you listening to me? Because that's the problem. Sometimes we put our trust in those material things. There's no place in the grave for the lamb. Am I right? There's no place in the grave for the cars and the house. And that's what we need to do. Learning to trust, to put our trust in Him who holds the future. Genesis said, as God created heaven, the sea, He looked, it was good. And then when He created human beings, He looked, and it was very good. That means the purpose for which God has created me, the purpose for which God has created you, is to make life, no, no, help me to finish, to make life very good. That's the purpose of which God has made us. So if we can make a full difference in the life of someone, let's do it. Humble Farm did it. He was the one invested in other people, rejoicing in other people's daily success. He was there for his children. He was there for his children. Michael, Annabelle, and Tom, I pray that God may give you son to follow the model that God, your dad, has left behind. But above all, learn to put your faith and hope and future in the hand of the one who is above all. And when you do that, that's when people say, come, you faithful servant. Come and take your crown of glory. Because I was hungry and you did what? You fed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. For whatever you do it, for the little one of those, you have done it for me. Come, you faithful servant. That's what we have been called to do. And our world today is in need of that. May God help us. All of us who have come, as I said, this world is not for all of us. It's for you. It's for you. It's for me. May God help us as we continue our spiritual journey. May we live to be worthy of the faith of Christ who loves and who never allow anything to separate us from His love. And again, may the soul of our dear Uncle Frank rest in perfect peace. Amen.
Amen.
Because He lives, we can face tomorrow. Amen. Death beckons. No one knows the day. Let us get ourselves ready. He's not talking about the cars or the buildings, the chandeliers. Think about that day. That day will come. Come buy all the candles. Come buy all the holy waters and put them under your pillows and things like that. You will die. Prepare for it. Are you here?
Yes.
You don't want to hear nothing? Prepare for it. It will come. Let us go. Holy God, we thank You for the love and care we receive in times of sorrow. Today we pray that You will grant the family, Auntie Jessie, Anita, Michael, Annabelle, all the grandchildren and everyone mourning today,
and show confidence in your love and care, that they may have the strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort and of a holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We have the presentation of the scepter. Please join in. Where is it? Are they coming to get the scepter for us?
It's here.
Is it there? To take a scepter.
There is a tradition that has to take place now. It's about transferring the power to Michael, as now Michael is now going to be the father of the house. So they are going to open the coffin, but we are not doing viewing. There is a scepter in there that they have to give to Michael. And Uncle will do that. So if Uncle will be ready to take that.
Yeah.
Great devil,
and see our friend with burial service. I have in hand this scepter, sent all the way from Usu Ra family, to be presented to a successor of Frank. In his sermon, Reverend Dr. Deji reminded us not to forget about the legacy Frank is leaving. This is a symbol of the role he played in chieftaincy affairs at Usu Kingawe. In order not to forget the role he played, they've chosen a successor. And he's no other person than his own son, Michael, named Dowuona.
Thank you.
I'm presenting this soul to you, Michael, so that you step in the shoes of your dad. And I have to warn you, if you accept this, it demands your time and resources. A role your dad played before he's dead. Michael, you accept this and step in the shoes of your late dad. Do you? I present this to you in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Accepted this. The two came together, so I have added the Spirit. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May He make His face to shine upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
If you are able to, let us start. Lord, we thank you for Cornelius, Francis Dowuona. The tribulation of this world are over and death is past. And we pray that you will bring us with him to the joy of your perfect kingdom. So Almighty God, Father of all mercies, and giver of all comfort, deal graciously with those who mourn, that they may cast every care on you and know the consolation of your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us now commend Cornelius Francis Dowuona to God. Into your keeping, O merciful God, we commend your servant, Cornelius Francis Dowuona. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the joy of everlasting peace, and in the glorious company of the saint in light, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let's say together the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
For time,
We are going to take our offertory as we sing the last hymn, and then Reverend will bless us as we go. This was a song, a hymn that Cornelius liked so much. So we'll sing us and take our offertory to bring to our supporting project here. They'll bring the folks around.
Row by row, we go out
And when we get out, we have about maybe 5 or 10 to start to say hello to one another. And then from there, we'll be going to Swedfield Road Cemetery.
Gentlemen, if I may have your attention, please. The cemetery says Strayfield Cemetery. However, it is best you go to Lavender Hill Cemetery because you can access Strayfield only via Lavender Hill.
Okay, so if we are able to follow, I know it's a little bit tricky, and I would advise you to put your head lights, or if you are driving, please drive. Not everyone will be going to the cemetery. For those who are not going to cemetery, we are aimed to be at the cemetery by 1:30. That's why we are we need to be there by 1:30. Those of who are not going to cemetery, you can go and go to the hall where the reception will take place. It's the boundary hall, it's the park. There, and we have given them instructions. They can give you refreshment while you are waiting for us. So let's do things in an orderly manner. So this is the fact. So there's no over right that will happen tomorrow. So this is the final right. So when we get to the hall, that's where everything will happen. Then the final rite will be there. So let's be disciplined and let's be careful as we drive. And, as I said, for those who may be going home, may God be with you. Those who may not see, Merry Christmas in advance to you. But please let do things in orderly. So we hear and the music be played as we go.
open the doors, please. We have to go now.
Getting ready to go to the cemetery, so stay tuned.
Thank you.
attention, please. As we make our way, please be mindful. We put this blue cover over the spot here. Try not to hit it.
Live streaming it to Ghana, so if I follow the cars, then they see the whole trail.
Just when you're in your uncle in this phrase of
people's throne. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, firm and firm deep in the Savior's throne. When the waters pour to your way desperate, the rising tide never fail, by your anchor holding heaven. We have an anchor that gives the soul steadfast and sure where the people's roll. Fasten to the rock which cannot we have an anchor that gives the soul steadfast and sure by the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, round and firm and deep in the Savior's
throne. Okay, dear friends, this is where all our human effort come to an end. We have just 2 minutes, about 10, 15 minutes to spend here. The Reverend Papa will do a short prayer, and we will do the committal, and then if symbolically you want to put the soil in, and then we let the funeral director use the sheet to finish it up. And are we allowed to stay here, or we can come back?
No, it depends. We need to create room for the
tractor. So we will vacate or create room. We create room for the machine. So we just do it symbolically, and they use the machine to finish.
To finish it. Yes.
Thank you. Mr. Papa.
Yes, sir.
As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction. To this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living.
Amen. Amen. So, Michael, Anita, Annabelle, since the earthly life of Cornelius Francis Dowuona has come to an end, we commit his body to be buried, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in sure and certain hope of a resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So God alone is holy and just and good. It is in that certainty that we have committed the body of Uncle Frank. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, for their rest from their living. And may his soul rest in perfect peace. Amen.
Amen.
Michael, Annabelle, please come if you want to be.
Thank you.
know the wife, she can
sit, she doesn't have to. Anyone else, please, grandchildren?
Keeping, leaving them.
Okay, so as we said, Reverend Papa will say the final prayer, the blessing, and then we'll make the way for the machine to come and finish. Yeah. Thank you.
Let us pray. Father, into your hands we commit the family once again. This is indeed a difficult time for them. But we trust in your faithfulness and your goodness and your mercies. Be around and about them. When they become desperate and do not have any hope, be their hope.
Amen.
Let your love surround them each and every day of their lives as they continue to journey in this world. Be with them and be with each and every one of us. In the name of Christ, amen.
Amen.
Now, Cornelius, go forth upon your journey, O Christian soul. In the name of God the Father who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ who suffered for you, in the name of the Holy Spirit who strengthens you, in communion with the blessed saints, with angels and archangels, and with all the heavenly host. Cornelius, Uncle Frank, may you rest in peace.
Amen.
And may the city of God be your eternal dwelling. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with us all and remain with us. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You want to encourage maybe one or two people?
Okay, I don't know. Michael, do you want to do it? Just okay, just do it, and then the machine will.
We can just take away the greens first before we start.
Okay.
We need to remove all the details.
Is it going to be very muddy?
I don't know.
Sorry.
Love you. We'll miss you. We'll never.
forget you until we meet together and laugh again. To Uncle Frank.
Thank
you so much. Very well. Thank you.
Thank you.
That to hold it, yeah, to be like a pillar for it, yeah.
Yeah, that would be lovely.
You're gonna hold it, okay?
Thank you.
You're welcome, sir. You have to stand there with your sisters so that I take a photo of you, okay?
My sisters have gone.
They've gone, okay,
yeah,
that's fine.
So I just need to take one
there, where the Ghana flag is, so I take a photo of you.
May, no, just
okay, that's fine.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah. You be alright?
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we finish with the interment of Uncle Cornelius. We are now going to the hall for reception. So, yeah, within the times that is stated on the link, you can check up, and if it started, then you can join us. Okay, but I know we are between 3 and 4. Yeah, so. Thank you all for your support, your love, and for everything that you've done for the family. We really appreciate it. Take care, and God bless you all.